The 6th of October 1944 was a critical day for the German 15th Army. The Canadian 1st Army was attacking with two army corps. The British 1st Corps was still threatening Tilburg, while the Canadian 2nd Corps was relentlessly attacking towards Berg op Zoom. The German 15th Army was with its back against the wall. Both Hitler and Field Marshal Model ordered that the line Antwerp-Tilburg-Zetterenbosch had to be held at all cost, while the Allies were gradually driving the army back. Gustav von Sangen, the 15th Army commander, followed up on this order by issuing a lengthy encouragement to his troops, which ended with the following phrases. The German people are watching us. In this hour, the fortifications along the Scheldt occupy a role which is decisive for the future of our people. Each additional day that you deny the port of Antwerp to the enemy and all his resources will be vital. Von Sangen was well aware of the strategic importance of the German positions on both sides of the Westerschelde, which was the entrance to the harbour of Antwerp. It was essential for these positions to keep the land bridge south of Berg op Zoom. For this reason, von Sangen sent up his last available reserve, the 15th Army Weapons Training Battalion. The reason for this desperate move was the Royal Hamilton Light Infantry, which broke through the German lines on October 6th. The same day, the Canadian Royal Regiment had defeated an improvised German battalion in the village of Ossendrecht. At nightfall, the only unit left between the Canadians and the vital railway on the Beveland Isthmus was the 15th Army Weapons Battalion. The attacking Canadian units belonged to the Canadian 2nd Infantry Division. This division had three infantry brigades, each consisting of three infantry battalions. Besides these regular infantry battalions, there was a machine gun battalion and a reconnaissance battalion. Of course, the division also had artillery and other organic units, but these units are the main frontline combat units. On October 6th, the 4th Brigade had taken the lead in the attack, and from October 7th, the 5th Brigade would take over the sector and perform the final attack to cut off the Beveland Isthmus. The Calgary Highlanders and the Regiment de Maisonneuve would be spearheading the attack with the Black Watch of Canada in reserve. In order to understand the battlefield, we have to look at the geography of the area. On the west, next to the seaside, are the flatlands with the polders, which are more often than not under the sea level. In the east, there is the so-called Brabantse Wall, a high ridge with dunes and forests which rise 20 to 30 meters above sea level. Even on the ridge itself, there are considerable differences in height. The village of Hogeheide was located almost 10 meters higher than the neighboring village of Woensdrecht. The border between those two distinct landscapes is also not gradual, but is a steep edge. It is important to control the high ground in order to dominate the flatlands of the Beveland Isthmus, where the rail link was situated, which was so vital for the Germans. In order to prevent a swift Allied advance in the flatlands, the Germans had flooded a significant part of the polders. On October 7th, the C Squadron of the 4th Garry Horse Tank Regiment was split up and divided between the Regiment de Maisonneuve and the Calgary Highlanders to give the infantry tank support for their planned advance on Hogeheide. Despite this support, the Regiment de Maisonneuve became stuck at a roadblock. The Calgary Highlanders on the left fared better and entered Hogeheide in the afternoon. The newly arrived German 15th Weapons Battalion tried to stop them, but they were unsuccessful due to the lack of anti-tank weapons. At nightfall, Hogeheide was partly in Canadian hands. The Canadian 5th Brigade smelled success and threw in the last battalion, the Black Watch of Canada, for the final dash to cut off the Beveland Isthmus. The Black Watch would not take the obvious route via Woensdrecht, but was directed to the north via Kortenven instead. In the morning of October 8th, the Calgary Highlanders and the Regiment de Masseneuve finished the liberation of Hoge Heide to clear the way for the Black Watch. The Black Watch attacked with the support of Sherman tanks from the Fort Garry Horse, but they were stopped in their tracks by desperate last-ditch defense of the men of the 15th Weapons Battalion. But German reinforcements were on the way. In the sector Tilburg, the offensive of the British 1st Corps had fizzled out, and as a result, von der Heydte's battle group could be pulled out and sent to the Berg op Zoom sector. The unit was beginning to act as a fire brigade of the 15th Army. Whenever a crisis at the front occurred, it was sent to deal with it. This also meant that its battalions were slowly burning out. Based on intelligence from prisoners of war, the Canadians estimated the 1st Battalion to have around 450 men. This was off the mark, but it was better than the German High Command, which had estimated its strength at 280 men. When the trucks arrived to pick up the Fallschirmjäger, 530 men turned up. Battalion Finzel, which had been an independent unit, was now formally part of von der Heydte's command, but with 300 men, its strength was significantly diminished after 1 month of action. The 3rd Battalion was in no better shape, with an estimated 300 men. The 4th Battalion was slightly stronger than the previous two battalions, with an estimated 350 men. This battalion was a kind of ghost unit, because it never appeared at the front line. It is likely that this battalion was a kind of reserve to absorb fresh reinforcements and returning convalescents, but also to harbor the reconnaissance company, which was a kind of elite. Canadian intelligence reports also reveal an interesting tactical development. The 1st Battalion was composed of four companies with four platoons each. Normally, all heavy weapons, like mortars and heavy machine guns, would be concentrated in one heavy company. In the new configuration, the heavy company would cede its platoons to the other companies while receiving infantry platoons. This would transform the heavy company into an infantry company. But most importantly, it shifted the focus from battalion level to company level. Within the company, each platoon would have three sections with two light machine guns each. The heavy platoon had three sections with a total of three or four mortars, one Panzerschreck and 5 to 6 Panzerfäuste. This meant the company was split up in small combat teams, supported by mortar pits and backed up by tank hunter teams. This downsizing of units did not diminish the striking power, because even the smallest combat team had a considerable punch, due to the high distribution of automatic weapons among the Fallschirmjäger. Meanwhile, the Canadian Army was also dealing with manpower issues. After the intense fighting in Normandy, the ranks had thinned out. We can illustrate that with the 5th Brigade, which would fight at Woensdrecht. On October 8th, battalions like the Regiment Masseneuve were only at 75% strength. Even if battalions had still a considerable strength on paper, the training of the men left a lot to be desired. On October 14, the Black Watch reported that 54% of the infantry had trained 2 months or more. The rest had only 4 weeks of basic infantry training or less. This meant that the Canadian forces looked superior on paper, but were actually struggling with shortages of trained men. Unfortunately for the Canadians, the Germans also got reinforcements in the form of assault guns. The 280th Assault Gun Brigade arrived in Berg op Zoom on October 8th with 8 assault guns, which would support von der Heydte's Fallschirmjäger in a planned counterattack. In preparation of their attack, the Germans also evacuated the villagers of Woensdrecht and Hoge Heide. The reason was that often civilians would inform the Allies about German troop positions and movements. But although the intention for evacuation was purely based on military consideration, this move saved countless civilian lives in the weeks to come. Another help for the Germans was the deteriorating weather conditions, which prohibited intervention of the Allied Air Force. The stage was set for a counterattack by von der Heydt's Fallschirmjäger before dawn on October 9th. 1 hour before sunrise, they attacked, hoping to take the Calgary Highlanders in Hoge Heide by surprise. Just like in previous attacks, the young German paratroopers had crawled towards the Canadian positions in order to infiltrate their lines. The Canadians managed to beat off the attacks, but during the day, the German mortar shelling intensified, and the paratroopers again tried to overrun the Canadian lines. But the Canadians held on, although only by a thread. The Canadians got a nasty surprise when the assault guns appeared in the streets of Hoge Heide to support the Fallschirmjäger. The first assault gun was, however, taken out by the Canadian infantry, after which the others retreated. There was no place for tanks in the battle for Hoge Heide. By the end of the day, the Canadians had taken considerable losses, especially among officers, and they were exhausted. They formulated their experience as followed. In reviewing the day's events, it was felt that A Company crack attack was a serious one. C Company's battle was terrific, but they had been able to hold out. That our front had been menaced by the remnants of two paratroop battalions. The neighboring Black Watch battalion also noticed the change of caliber of the troops in front of them. The troops we are now meeting are definitely the cream of the crop. They belong to paratroop battalions. They range in age from 20 to 26 years, are fine specimens, keen to fight and with excellent morale. All day long there was heavy fire from artillery and mortar on our positions, and his snipers are very busy. The German snipers were focused on taking out officers, and as a result, the officer losses mounted considerably, seriously crippling command. It was clear by now that the roles on the battlefield were reversed by the arrival of von der Heydt's men. The Canadians were now being attacked, instead of being the attackers. It took the command of the Canadian 2nd Infantry Division some time to get used to the new situation. General Fox was visiting the headquarters of the 5th Brigade on October 9th in order to follow the attack of the Canadian forces up close, but he had to be convinced by the brigade commander to break off the attack and go on defense in the face of a new opposition. The next day it became clear that the Canadian forces were exhausted and had taken significant losses. The Royal Hamilton Light Infantry relieved the Calgary Highlanders and the Black Watch, which needed a rest. Brigade command issued a 48 hours period of rest for the troops. Meanwhile, the Royal Regiment of Canada had advanced from Ossendrecht through the flooded lowlands. In the late afternoon, the forward company reached the Hoofdweg in the Damespolder. The Beveland Isthmus was in danger of falling into Canadian hands, and the Fallschirmjäger were called upon to remedy the situation. The first company was sent to block the road into Woensdrecht to prevent the Canadian attack into the rear of the German positions in Hoge Heide. Von der Heydt sent his best company, Karl Wiegand's 16th Company, with two assault guns to the railway embankment for a counterattack. The counterattack faltered in the face of Canadian counterfire, and the two assault guns were soon immobilized by anti-tank weapons and the mud. In turn, the B Company of the Royal Regiment tried to outflank the Germans, but they were caught by the automatic weapons of Wiegand's company. The A Company also tried to stretch the Germans by attacking the eastern flank. Wiegand had a mere 50 men, but he managed to hold off a whole battalion of Canadian troops. His troops even counterattacked with flamethrowers in a bid to throw the Canadians back in the western sector. His men had the literal high ground and sprayed the Canadians in the polder below with their automatic weapons. The Canadians did not hope to conquer the railway embankment that day. The German paratroopers began to dig in. The race for the Beveland Isthmus was over, and von der Heydt's regiment arrived in the nick of time to blunt the Canadian advance, which would otherwise have been successful in cutting through the German land link to Zeeland. The Canadians had been taken by surprise and suffered significant losses in men and officers, but the German paratroopers had also suffered dozens of casualties. Both parties licked their wounds in a welcome respite, but the Canadians were already planning for the next attack in another bid to break through to the strategic Beveland Isthmus.